modern-day Indiana Jones. This is a guy who travels around the jungles of Latin America, speaking with indigenous peoples, truly sitting down and listening to traditional healers, and in so doing, discovering medicines, cures, and techniques unknown to science. He is an extremely special person, and I say that not only because we went to the same high school in New Orleans, although that's important too. But he's great. We're so lucky to have him back here at Beyond Tomorrow. It's always wonderful to have him Plotkin at Harvard, and I'm thrilled to say we're honored to have him.
Great to be back. Nice to see some faces from last year again. Thanks to Marcella, Jed, and Michael on putting this spectacular gathering together. And to answer your question, I trained at the MCZ, and Stephen Jay Gould held court there, and he, of course, came up with the idea of evolutionary theory of punctuated equilibrium, where evolution would happen rapidly and then sort of slow down or even stop. Gould had many detractors, which many bright people and many outspoken people do, and he was attacked for this. This was called evolution by jerks. So Gould responded and said, well, if you believe that evolution happens slowly and at a steady rate, it doesn't, but this would have to be called evolution by creeps. Now, the focus of our symposium this weekend is creativity, and we've already heard several different definitions. For me, creativity has to involve novelty and utility. So according to my mother's definition, if a politician in Washington makes shit up, that's not creativity, that's lying. Just to be clear. What's this? It's two blocks from here. Who knows what this building is? It's the Yenching Library. I took this picture to cut out the Chinese lions to make it a little harder to identify. Now, I'm going to tie a lot of things together, so I'm going to move fast. I walk past this building every day for 8 years, and there's something that always mystified me. This right here. Take a look when you're on Divinity Avenue. The Yenching Library is the study of East Asia. Look at this. What is it now? East Asian languages when I was there. East Asian studies. You're shaking your head. What is it now? Okay, you don't know. You're responding to my question. Sorry. Here is a map of the world, and the middle of the map of the world is the Northwest Amazon. East Asia is way over here. What the hell's going on here? It took a lot of sleuthing to figure it out. But natural history and the Amazon begins at Harvard with Louis Agassiz. Agassiz was a famous geographer, came to Boston in the 80s, wowed everybody in Boston. They gave him a tenured position at Harvard, and he set out to make Harvard the crossroads of natural history in North America and the world. He essentially built the Museum of Comparative Zoology, also known as the Agassiz Museum, which they've given some homogenized name now, but it'll be ever forever tied to the legacy of Agassiz. And one of the many reasons he built the Agassiz Museum, the Museum of Comparative Zoology, was to house this, the famous Harvard mastodon, one of the most famous fossils of the 19th century, which is the centerpiece of the greatest murder case of the 19th century. Even Alan Dershowitz wrote about this, but I'm sure everybody at Harvard is well familiar with this case, so I won't go into it. Maybe we can touch on it in Q&A. However, Agassiz in 1859 was at the height of his powers, the height of his fame, universally known, beloved, had built this museum, except he had a problem. And that problem was Charles Darwin and the Origin of Species. Agassiz decided Darwin was wrong, and instead of being open-minded like a good scientist is supposed to be, which of course we all are, he attacked Darwin, and it caused his downfall. Agassiz, who was an expert on geology, created the term Ice Age, was the world authority on Brazilian fish, because when Spix and Natter came back from the Amazon and Spix died early, Agassiz was given the collection by Cuvier to diagnose and describe, then went to work on fossil fish. He was the world authority on Brazilian fish, never having set foot in Brazil. In 1865, Agassiz was determined to prove Darwin wrong, get stuff that nobody had in any museum in the world for his museum, and launched the Thayer expedition. Needless to say, he didn't prove Darwin wrong because Darwin was right. But one of his field assistants was William James, walking a little further down Divinity Avenue. And James, whose previous contact with humanity was rich white people in Boston and Europe, was exposed to Stone Age Indians, Afro-Brazilians, hunters, hunter-gatherers, fishermen, peasants of all stripes, and undoubtedly this influenced his thinking and understanding of the human psyche, and he then later became the father of American psychiatry. This is the greatest Harvard graduate you've never heard of. This is Alexander Hamilton Rice. Rice went to Harvard College. He then went to Harvard Medical School. 1901, when he was in Harvard Medical School, he said, I want to be an Amazon explorer. And he sailed to Ecuador, climbed the Andes, went down the other side, and recreated Oriana's voyage for the first time since Oriana done in the early 1500s, and decided he would devote his life to the exploration of the Amazon. In 1915, already holding 2 degrees from Harvard, Rice received an honorary degree. Now that was the most important commencement in Harvard history, and I say that for several reasons. The oration was given by an undergraduate by the name of E.E. Cummings. The song was composed by John Harvard's only familial descendant, whoever attended Harvard, as far as I know, and Widener Library was dedicated. Okay. And Eleanor Widener was on the die with Hamilton Rice, and Rice, who knew a good thing when he saw it, married her. She was one of the richest women in the world. Her monies turbocharged his career. He went to the Amazon. Instead of just going there with a couple of Indians, like I usually do it, his last expedition had 100 people, his own plane, his own boat. So her money turbocharged his career. He invented mapping the rainforest from the air. Okay. So Google Earth comes from Hamilton Rice and Harvard University. And the next time you walk down Divinity Avenue, look at the Yenching Library, and you'll see that it was designed by Trumbull, the same architect as Widener Library, a resemblance you may not have noticed previously. Shamans argue for the interconnectedness of all things. And if you walk inside the Yenching Library, which I never did for 8 years, you will see this plaque devoted to Hamilton Rice and recognizing his great contribution to mapping and cartographic science. Rice influenced my mentor, Schultes. Richard Evan Schultes, the father of ethnobotany, went to the Amazon for 6 months in 1941. The war broke out, and Roosevelt's emissary to Colombia told Schultes, who came out of the jungle to enlist, get your ass back to the rainforest and cut rubber because the Japanese had captured all the rubber plantations. Schultes essentially went native for 14 years. And his story is told in great detail in a story map on our website, amazonteam.org. I can give you that address again afterwards, in a completely new format, combining his story, his biography by Wade Davis, his pictures, which are magnificent, and even the specimens here in the Harvard Herbaria in one-stop shopping on one website. This is Schultes as I met him. He, in his classroom, charmed, entranced many people, not just ethnobotanists. Andrew Weil was a student of Schultes. Dan Goleman, emotional intelligence, was a student of Schultes. And E.O. Wilson, the greatest biologist of the 20th century, and so far the 21st century as well, said his personal hero was Schultes. So in Schultes' footsteps, I and some of my colleagues created the Amazon Conservation Team 20 years ago. And this is the most efficient and effective rainforest conservation organization you've never heard of. We're all refugees from organizations you have heard of, like the World Wildlife Fund, the Nature Conservancy. And we saw that 25% of the Amazon, less at the time, was in national parks, and 25% was in indigenous lands. National parks are protected by 3 park guards, who go home on the weekend, and indigenous lands are protected by thousands of people with poison-tipped arrows. Which would you invade first? So now we have 50% of the Amazon under protection by working with the indigenous peoples to give them the technological tools to marry ancient shamanic wisdom and 21st century technology. And that's going to be the focus of the rest of my talk. I don't want to fail to mention that last time I was here, people said, oh, didn't you bring any books? We want a book. We want more information. So this year I brought some books. We'll talk about this afterwards. I've been at this a long time. And one of the lessons I learned from Schultes was that you can't do ethnobotany in a hurry. We're Americans. We're the original get shit done people, right? Cut to the chase. We don't want to hear about the magic smoke. We don't want to drink hallucinogens. Just give me the plants you use to treat diabetes. Schultes always said the difference between an anthropologist and an ethnobotanist is when the shaman offers the hallucinogenic brew to the anthropologist, she or he says, oh, I can't do that because I lose my objectivity, whereas the ethnobotanist essentially says, yeehaw. So I have relationships with some of these shamans that go back over three decades, and it's created a very different dynamic than the usual scientific process of dropping your graduate student in a village and telling her or him, okay, I'll be back in a year, get lots of data, collect lots of plants. And I believe this is the way that ethnobotany should be done. This is with my colleague Kamanya, who I started working with in 1982. This is 1984, and this is last year. Same two guys working together. I showed this to a friend of mine, and she said, well, gee, your notebook's gotten a lot bigger. And I said, you know, as the brain shrinks, the notebook has to go. So I did a TED Talk last year, and then I took it to the village where I did the research and gave the TED Talk in the local language. So here's Kamanya right here sitting next to me. And I showed the picture of the magic frog. The magic frog is used for hallucinogenic and divinatory purposes in the Northwest Amazon. It's now being developed into a new treatment for blood pressure using a completely different therapeutic pathway than current treatments. When I showed this picture, Kamanya said, oh, we have that frog here. And I said, no, you don't. And he said, yes, we do. And I said, no, you don't. He says, yes, we do, and we use it for that purpose. And I said, I've been working there 30 years. You never told me about this frog. He said, you've been working there 30 years. You never asked me. And here is a great ayahuasca shaman of the Northwest Amazon who heads our program in Amazonian Colombia. Ayahuasca was, of course, discover is a relative term, like Columbus discovered America, the Indians got there first. But scientifically, it was discovered and described by Schultes, published in the Harvard Botanical Museum leaflet, circulation 17. Nobody read this for 30 years, and now you can buy this stuff on the internet. So the upside is it's being used to revolutionize certain aspects of psychiatric treatment, to go back to William James. And I keynoted a panel at the Boston Museum of Science last year. In fact, it was while I was doing this, I was running back and forth on the tee. Where three physicians are presenting clinical data talking about curing, not just treating, but curing PTSD, end-of-life trauma, and depression. So medical science is finally waking up to this brand new thing these shamans have been using for 50,000 years. Of course, we know what the rainforest is supposed to look like, and unfortunately, we know what it increasingly looks like. The reason this is topical is, again, 30 years ago when I went into this, I remember somebody said to me, I'll never forget this. A woman said, rainforest, who gives a shit about that? We have to worry about population growth. Now people say, the rainforest, oh, that's so 1980s. We need to worry about climate change. It's all the same thing, right? Population growth is destroying the rainforest, which is driving climate change. Burning of forests is the number two source of these bad gases going into the air. You want to fight climate change? Protect the forest. It's straightforward. If you're in a little boat and it's leaking, first thing you do is not bail. The first thing you do is plug the damn leak. Then you bail. People don't get that. This is the most important image I'm going to show you. I took this in a little plane flying over the eastern border of the Xingu Indigenous Reserve in the state of Mato Grosso in eastern Brazil. This is the eastern border of the Indian Reserve. Here you have 14 tribes of Indians. Here you have white guys. Here you have essentially pristine forest. You know, there isn't a single tree here, just some skinny-ass cows, okay? Here you have carbon sequestered. Here you have carbon released in the atmosphere. This is why we work with Indians to protect rainforests. So what did we do? We brought in GPSs. We taught them how to map. And this has revolutionized their understanding of the limits, the legal limits of their territory, and where they best focus their protection efforts. When you give the Indians better technology than the bad guys have, it's very powerful. It, to quote one of my favorite philosophers, Bruce Lee, in Enter the Dragon, it's the art of fighting without fighting. So we've done this now throughout the northern Amazon. This is the first map we made, 2000 actually. So I want to focus on this part of Trio Indian territory. This is in the northeast Amazon, the Suriname-Brazil border. And this is what it originally looked like. At the time, there was no Google Earth, imagine that. And this is the aerial imagery we had. Okay, when we got the first aerial imagery, a single pixel was 30 yards. Now it's 50 square centimeters. Okay, so we went from a third of a football field to less than a banana leaf. Zooming down culturally, I want to show you the land of the Acurios. These are hunter-gatherers. When they were first contacted over 30 years ago, they had no agriculture, and they didn't know how to make fire. Okay, this is my friend Pone. He taught me a joke in Acurio. In Acurio, fire is life. So when you meet an Acurio, the first thing you say to him is, Mato Nenge, which means, has your fire gone out? Which a double entendre means, are you dead? This is, in the Acurio culture, hilarious. So it's my only joke in Acurio, but it always gets a great reaction. These folks who once roamed, I mean, all of the Americas, essentially hunter-gatherers, when they came across the Bering Strait, are down to a few isolated bands. We calculate there are about 70 in the Amazon, most of them in the northwest Amazon. Much of my efforts today are focused on protecting these people and their forests. But because I've known these people for 30 years, I'm getting the inside scoop of what it was like to live with them. They are regarded as the masters of the forest by the other Indians, who consider them, these are all the isolated tribes, who regard them as the best hunters, the most knowledgeable. They have 35 words for honey. And so we've started a sustainable honey project, harnessing their wisdom to show the Indians, the other Indians who look down on them because they don't make fire, that these guys know stuff that they don't, and are using that in ways to protect the forest and create a substance which doesn't involve cutting down a single tree. So why are these people isolated? You know, they know the outside world exists, and you know what clued them that the outside world exists? It's kind of interesting. Airplanes. When airplanes started coming over, they knew there was an outside world. Certainly some of them knew there was an outside world because they'd fled during the rubber times and to escape disease. But one of the interesting things they told me was they thought that little cargo planes, single-engine Cessnas flown by the missionaries, were big, and that airliners that flew overhead were small, right? Because they're this big when they fly over. And the noise that certain 727s make is very similar to the sacred flutes. That caused a lot of confusion. So just documenting these stories is endlessly fascinating. Here is why so many of these people still hide today, particularly in the northwest Amazon. Now, certainly some of this is just a reaction to 1492. That people have hidden, but with the rubber atrocities in the Casa Arana on the Peru-Colombia border, driven by this evil man, Julio Cesar Arana, these people fled and are hiding still. And my mentor, Schultes, when he went to the Northwest Amazon in 1941, saw Indians missing fingers and missing ears, which had been chopped off because they didn't bring in their rubber quota. Remember when rubber was invented, like America was discovered. It was used for dirigibles, bicycle tires, automobile tires. So a lot of white guys made a lot of money torturing, enslaving, and killing Indians. So once again, the capitalist system wasn't very good to the people at the bottom of the pyramid. The history, the recent history of people who've come out of isolation, these are the Nukaks, it's not very good. Within a year or two, essentially, the elders and the youngest members of the tribe die. And remember, these are preliterate cultures. So the elders are the ones that know where to hunt, where to fish, what medicinal plants to use. So these libraries are disappearing. And this is even with the best of Western medicine, many of these people die. I think there's an element of depression here. These people take to their hammock, they have no obvious manifestations of disease, and they just die. So here's my mentor again, Schultes, and his most famous photo on Chiribiquete in the northwest Amazon. Schultes found this area, reported to the Colombian government, and it turned out that Hamilton Rice had actually mapped it in 1912. I found the maps in the bowels of the basement of the Library of the Royal Geographic Society, which Hamilton Rice and Eleanor Widener's money also built in London. And Schultes came back to Bogota and said, we have to protect this area. It took him 46 years to convince the Colombian government, Schultes and his Colombian colleagues, and this was set aside as a national park in 1989. That's an overflight I did a year ago. It is spectacular. Now this is a bastion of biological diversity, but it's much more. It's the richest repository of pre-Columbian art in the world. There are tens of thousands of drawings that we know of, and the area is very poorly explored. There's been very little exploration since Schultes in 43 and Rice in 1912. And you not only have biological diversity, you not only have this incredible expression of Amerindian art, you have three tribes of isolated Indians. One, two, three. And thanks to the vision of President Santos of Colombia, the borders were expanded 2 years ago to incorporate the isolated tribes, biological diversity, art, and uncontacted tribes. Talk about one-stop shopping in terms of biocultural diversity. So I think this is the most important protected area in the Amazon, and certainly one of the most important protected areas in the world. To the trained eye, looking at the malocas, the roundhouses, you can tell cultures apart. And this culture is different than this one. And this one is different than this one. So we have documentation of what we think are 14 different tribes. And we have passed the legislation to protect them. And to protect them, you got to protect a lot of forest around them. And to protect a lot of forest around them, you're protecting the world against further climate change. So again, it's truly a win-win-win situation. But we don't make the mistake at the Amazon Conservation Team that other environmental organizations have made over and over again, which is pass a law in Washington or Bogota or wherever, make a circle on a map and think you've won the war. You haven't won the war. You won a battle. You got to do it on the ground. So we've identified all the egress points, all the places where people get in and out, and put guard stations there. And the guard stations are manned by members of the Colombian Park Service, which is crackerjack, and local indigenous peoples, contacted peoples, who want to keep the outside world at bay and give their isolated brothers and sisters a chance to survive. We also train indigenous park guard forces, which patrol the borders, protect the forests, keep the gold miners out, and learn medicinal plants in the process. In the old days, nobody wanted to mess with isolated Indians. And here's why.
Now, did you Photoshop that picture?
I cannot tell a lie. This is an art exhibit in Havana, Cuba. These are some Cuban artists, their depiction of why you shouldn't fly low over isolated Indian tribes. You shouldn't fly low over isolated Indian tribes, but when you show this to bush pilots, it's an added incentive to sort of keep away. Like I said, when these people come out of isolation, these are mashcopiros in the Peruvian Amazon who came out because they were being shot at by gold miners, because their roundhouses were being burned by gold miners, because they were being chased by missionaries, and they just showed up on this riverbank begging. This is not an acceptable situation, and it's completely avoidable. So the point I want to close with is that it's all connected. Climate change, new drugs from nature, shamanic traditions, sustainable agriculture, new crop products. you can't just segment one of these things out and do it successfully. Like the shamans say, it's all connected. And one of the reasons that I'm excited to be here is because people here get this in a way that some of our countrymen just don't seem to quite yet. And so we are here to think beyond tomorrow. In Louisiana, where Jed and I come from, which is the northern edge of Latin America, we have lots of great dichos, lots of great sayings. One of my favorites is, don't look back, you're not going there. Here we are looking not just tomorrow, but beyond tomorrow. But my argument is that you've got to look back to look forward, and you have to do both at the same time. Thank you very much.
Now, I'm sure you're going to have questions, so I'm going to get up and move over to you who have questions so that everybody can hear them. So who would like to be first with a question? Coming on down over there. God, I feel like Phil Donahue. Here I come. I have to keep this right up here.
Thank you, Mark. I enjoyed that immensely. Could you go back to that little airplane picture, the Cuban bit of art? I just wanted to comment on the extra irony there that Piper named all of their airplanes after Native American tribes.
Thank you for that added tidbit.
Ah, you're right here.
Right next door.
That's good.
Yeah, hi. My name's Susan. I'm a pediatrician, and I'm class of 84, Adams House. And I was interested in the aspect of your talk about using plants for medicinal purposes. In Massachusetts, this has come up recently with medicinal marijuana, which I have a lot of opinions about as a pediatrician. But I'm confused with the science part of my brain about how to incorporate how I was trained, which is double-blind placebo studies with 50,000 years of experience. And I just was wondering if in your work you've given thought to somehow cross-educating both sides of that way of taking scientific information into the medicinal world.
It's a good
thoughts?
Question, and it's not the first time I've been asked it. And if there is no easy answer, in Suriname they have a great saying, which is, to any complicated question there is always a solution which is both simple and wrong. I was thinking about that a lot yesterday, but that's another lecture. Ethnobotany has been criticized as saying, well, it's not science. Well, if these guys have 15,000 years of human experimentation, it is science. If a shaman cures me of X, that's not science. Actually, it is science. It's a hypothesis. N equals one, and you got to grow it out. Now, the flip side of this is the double-blind clinical trials, which are, of course, as scientific as you can make it. But the difficult part is in between, and I get this question a lot, or this, it's not really a question, it's a very stupid statement, usually in Berkeley. Dude.
No, don't say that.
Dude, ethnobotany, cool, I'd never go to a doctor. Well, then don't get appendicitis, because you'll die, right? Or another one, dude, plants, man, I only take plants because they can't hurt you. Really, dude, you ever heard of strychnine? So this is foolish. But I don't believe what every shaman tells me any more than I believe what every doctor tells me. So it's incumbent on all of us to make our own decisions. And I have all sorts of people telling me they're ayahuasca shamans because they went to Esalen and took ayahuasca for a weekend, and now they want a cure with it. Well, it's not that easy, I don't think, even though some people get results. So stick with the science. Would be open-minded. And a shaman who is going to treat you, who is well-known and well-regarded in the Amazon and is not all about the money, I trust more than somebody who's advertising on the internet and saying for $3,000 you come here and have a completely traditional ayahuasca ceremony with marijuana and magic frogs and some datura on the side. So again, we have to make informed decisions. It's not as easy as I would like it to be, but it's a lot easier than it used to be.
And do you ever try to educate the shamans in maybe data collection to kind of enhance the cross-pollination of ideas?
We published work on our Shaman's Apprentice clinics where we had clinical evaluation of what they were coming in with and what the results were. And that was done with a physician. So we're very careful not to promote anecdotal information as scientific studies, because there's overlap, but it ain't the same thing. There's definitely a much greater need for more of that. You look at Rosita Arvigo, who went down there and trained with the last of the great Mayan midwives or mid-husband, it was a guy, right? So there is room for scientists and physicians, which aren't always the same thing, to do this type of work and document it. And in so doing, you act as a catalyst, because all the young kids think, hey, this must be cool and important, because the guy with the most current cell phone is, you know, working with grandpa. So that's the origin of our Shaman's Apprentice program, which maybe I'll give a lecture on next year. Other questions?
Well, he's going to make me come all the way back to the other side. That's all right. I need the workout. Here I come. I bet this is going to be on Darwinism.
No, it's not. You talked about different groups or tribes, maybe, and I wondered how much cultural exchange there was between tribes. And I don't mean the type that you talked about trying to transfer information consciously, as outsiders, but that has gone on. How much transfer of cultural information is there across tribes? To what extent are languages, distinct languages, barriers? How much transfer is there for outbreeding, you know, in order to avoid inbreeding? Does it stay within the tribe, or does it go outside of linguistic groups? I mean, there's a whole bunch of questions.
Right. I think this is a lecture I'll come in 2 years from now. The answer is nobody knows, but there are observations that are relevant to your question. For example, in a village, in a tribe, the shamans all use the same plant, but they may use it for different diseases. They may prepare it differently. They may give it in different doses. The further you move from one village and one tribe, the more it changes. There are some plants that are used from one side of the Amazon to the other. I had a very interesting experience in Oaxaca, following on Schulte's footsteps. He's the guy who found magic mushrooms there in the 30s, as his PhD thesis at Harvard, where the shaman said, look, she said, I'll tell you anything you want to know, but you have to promise me one thing. I said, what's that? She said, don't tell the other shamans from my tribe. So it was sort of a reverse shaman's guild, where she didn't want her information used by anybody she competed with for business. Pardon?
Intellectual property.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, that's about as grassroots as intellectual property rights stuff gets. And no one is second to me in championing the importance of the protection of this IPR stuff, but I find people in this country a lot more exercised about it than Indians, who are scrambling for ways to make a living outside of going to the gold fields. So this whole issue of how much they know, and, well, they'll teach it to their kids, but they won't teach it to other people in our Shamans and Apprentice programs. There is a proprietary nature to some of the stuff, where it's only passed down within a lineage, within a tribe.
Have any outsiders embarked on either a phylogenetic or a phylocultural tree within Amazonia?
I haven't seen anybody do this from an ethnobotanical perspective, but I think this would be fascinating and very timely while the information is still alive. I mean, our major focus at the organization is to protect it. But documenting it is a way of protecting it, not just for ourselves. I don't publish this type of information, but when you come in, when you drop from the sky and this is what you want to learn, it gives a new credence to the importance of it, the international interest in it, and why kids should be interested in it. So I think in addition to the pure intellectual exercise of seeing what it would tell us about how long these tribes have been separate, when they came with the Bering Strait, and all that other interesting stuff, some of which is being answered now through better archaeology and genetics, will have a positive spin in terms of the conservation of it as well.
I'm coming.
More road work there,
Michael. I'm coming around the mountain. David, did you have your?
Thank you, sir. That has spurred me. You're protecting these these communities.
Right.
What's your perspective as you look forward 20 years, 50 years, 100 years, 250 years? What are the prospects, particularly in a world where quite the opposite is obviously underway, so-called globalization, communications, transportation, technology, which are jamming people together, and most in particular, their contact with the outside world, which starts with you and the forebears to you that you've described, as well as those who come after. It's inevitable that these people see firsthand in yourselves this outside world. What's we can see the very great importance of protecting, and yet, I'm very curious what your perspective on that is.
Excellent set of questions. I would suspect that a lot of us feel a lot more under siege now than we did a couple of months ago, and that the pace of change is outstripping maybe what we'd like, and some of the things that we prefer to avoid seem to be stuck in our face. So we're all in the same boat. However, my job, is not to tell these people what to do or what not to do. As I see it, is to help them make informed decisions. If they wanted to go to the gold fields, that's their decision. But I've taken them up and flown them over gold fields and over deforested areas and say, this is what happens when you sell the trees off to these guys who say they're going to give you jobs and money and pots and pans and so on and so forth. But ultimately, it's your decision. So clearly, some of these forests are going to go. Some of these cultures are going to go. But not as much as would go if they didn't have like-minded people saying, look, this is why it's worth protecting, this is how you do it, here's some tools, here's some salaries as park rangers and things like that until they can get on their own feet. They're now making money from a lot of this stuff, which they weren't before. And if the only way you can make money is do bad and destructive things, you'll do it, okay? Going back to the previous lecture. But giving people options and giving them a chance to breathe and think about things and make more informed decisions than just operating out of desperation is a better way to manage your life and your future. So I am ultimately hopeful, but I will say this. When I started, I said, I want to make the world a better place. Well, I'm a bit more beat up now. I say, I want to make the world a less bad place, and I'm willing to settle for that. Yes.
Up, 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 up.
Here, I'll pass it over. Yeah. You just hear so much about the deforestation of the Amazon, and I don't mean to be naive because I know it's a very complicated biological system, but is there any attempt at reforestation or leaving land fallow, hoping that it'll grow back or anything? Because it always just seems so negative, we just hear more and more lost. So I'm wondering if there's anything in that direction.
Again, I'm with you. There's enough degraded lands to meet most of the world's needs for wood and other forest products. It's much better to regrow what's been lost and try and harvest that. So this idea that we should have no net loss of Amazon forest as a goal, I have two problems with that. My mother's an English teacher. There's two negatives in that goal. That's a bad thing. Our goal should be more forest, not less. So I think that all programs aimed at addressing climate change should be have as a partial aim, regrowing forest everywhere, not just the Amazon. Can you grow a true and pristine rainforest? Most people would say no. One of the botanists I respect the most says yes, but it takes 700 years. In any case, many of the purposes for which the forest is being felled are not necessary. Okay, firewood. You can grow firewood. Take the fastest growing species and plant them, right? But when you live in an infinite present, as many of these Indians have for 15,000 years, there's always more trees to cut down, so that's what you do. So there needs to be some changing of mentality in order to get people to think about positive things they should be doing instead of not doing negative things. So I'm with you. That being said, I don't think our lifespan is going to be expanded to 700 years in any of our lifetimes. I hope not. So the idea, oh, well, we'll just regrow it and we'll end up with what we started. So we need to protect the seed corn first and foremost and regrow all the other stuff around the edges.
I'm just wondering if there is any actual program that's trying to do that, or is there any initiative in that direction?
Well, there's lots of reforestation programs in the tropics. There should be more and they should be better. I mean, you look at California and it's full of eucalyptus. Eucalyptus is an ecological desert. Why the hell are they planting that garbage? And it burns like crazy. Should be planting native species or other species that are more eco-friendly, I think. Any other questions? And I'll say one final thing.
I have one question. I was really taken by the art that you showed in your presentation. And the question that I have is, do you know, can you show, does, what kind of stories come out of that art? What's the storytelling like?
That's the lecture I'll give 3 years from now. That art was created, as far as we know, by the Carijones. The Carijones are the westernmost extent of the Carib tribes. The Caribs are the original cannibals. Now, cannibalism is debated in some parts of the anthropological community, saying, oh, that's just white people dehumanizing these people so they could have an excuse to go in there and beat Christianity into them. But I met one of the last of the Carijones, and I said, is it true your ancestors were cannibals? He said, absolutely. And I said, you want to tell me about that? And he said, well, we ate a lot of white people, but we ate a lot more huitotos. They were really our enemies. And I said, well, what more can you tell me? And his Spanish was worse than mine. It was very funny. He said, lo ganamos y después lo comemos, all present tense. So we beat them and then we eat them. It's pure poetry in English. But that's who we think created that art. And the reason we know that is in the art is the maraque. The maraque is a sacred rite of the Caribs where they would take these horrible stinging wasp and ants and apply them to the chest of young male initiates to teach them to be able to withstand anything. And that's not practiced in the other tribes, which, because there are no more Carib tribes there. So that's why we think they're Carijones. But we don't know, you know. It's worth redoing. And there's a story from 2 years ago in Colombia that two young boys had escaped the FARC, the guerrillas, and were trying to find their way out of the forest. And they came upon two uncontacted Indians painting on a wall in Chiribiquete. So that tradition lives. But right now, that's just, you know, something out of Garcia Marquez. It's not proven, but I've heard it from several people, and I'd love to go investigate.
Ladies and gentlemen, I want to thank Dr. Mark Plotkin.
Okay. Thank you all.